All right, so it's been a couple of weeks since we've been right here studying. We kind of started this little short little series called What is the Gospel? The Gospel just means what? What do we translate the Gospel as? What is it?
Good news.
Good news, right? So what's the good news, right? That's what we're talking about. So 2 weeks ago, we started talking about who is God. We talked about who is God, and this is what we said. We said who is God? First slide, James. God is, first, he's our good creator. So he made us. I feel like I can't see y'all down there. He made us, right? He made everything. So he made us with purpose, right? Just like a car maker makes everything with purpose. And he's good, so he didn't make us with this bad purpose, right? He created us good. And he is our creator. But number two, God is righteous and loving. So he, what it means that he is righteous means what? Somebody, what do you remember? If he's righteous, what does that mean?
Right.
He's right, okay.
Just.
He's just, he's fair. So, is that what you said? So, if he's like a judge, right, and somebody comes before him and has committed a crime, he can't let that go. Now, he has to punish it fairly. But he's also loving, and he wants us to be in relationship with him, and so he's both of those at the same time. So we talked about that. And we talked about who is man. 2 weeks later, I think there was a tornado between us. We talked about who is man. One, we were created good, right? God made us the way he made you. He made you just like you are. Right? He made you on purpose, just like you are. He also created us with choice, right? So we could choose, are we going to do what God says or are we not going to do what God says, right? We get the choice. And what we did as humanity, all of us, and Adam and Eve specifically, we chose our own way. We chose rebellion, not life. Because if we do what God says, it leads to life, as he says. But if we do what we want, eventually it leads to death. Number three, we're all sinners. There's this popular belief in our culture here in East Texas that, no, I'm good. I'm a good person. I'm this, I'm that. God will let us all in the end. But all of us are sinners, every one. There's not one of us that's empty of that. And then four, we talked about sin's penalty of death. And really what we said was this. Sin is like cancer. Remember how we talked about cancer? I think I diagnosed Ethan with a brain tumor or something like that. Sin is like cancer. And it doesn't want to just kind of get in there and play around. It wants to destroy us. And sin's desire is not to leave us alone, but to destroy us. So really, none of that is good news so far. If you're really paying attention, you're like, all right, that's not good news. You told me that I'm going to die because of my sin. Okay, but that's why we're here this week. We're going to get to the good news. So this week we're going to talk about the cure, right? If sin is like cancer, then what's our cure? What's the cure to that? So we're going to talk about who is Jesus. Because if I asked you, the Sunday school answer would be to this question. What's the cure to your sin? So many of you would go, Jesus. Jesus. That's exactly how you answer. That tone and everything. Right? But how is he our cure? So we're going to talk about who God is, or who Jesus is. So first, Jesus, this is mind-blowing. We're just going to just drop a truth bomb right here. First, Jesus is fully God and fully man. Now, I don't know about you. I don't know if you're a math person or not. Who's a math person? Who is terrible at math? All right, let me give you, Lexi, let me give you an easy math question. No, this is as easy as it gets. First one you learn, you ready? What is 1 plus 1? It's 2, got it? That is the most basic math function you've ever learned, right? 1 plus 1 is 2. But, okay, here's what we just said though. Jesus is 100% God, and 100% man. So does that make him 2? No. Right? So it's not 1 plus 1 equals 2, which, again, I don't even understand completely. Let's read it. Philippians 2, verses 5 through 8 says this. You must have the same attitude that Christ Jesus has. So he's going to describe who Jesus is. Verse 6. Though he was God, hear that? Though he was God. He is God, but he was God too. Though he was God, he did not think of equality with God as something to cling to. He didn't hold on to the fact that he was God. No, you can't send me down to earth. I'm God. is verse 7. Instead, he gave up his divine privileges, and he took the humble position of a slave, and was born as a human being. When he appeared in human form, he humbled himself in obedience to God and died a criminal's death on a cross. So he's fully God. We know that. He is divine. He's not just any other man, but he's also fully human, right? So if he was just fully God and he never came as a man, we would not know him as our Savior, because he would never come and die. But if he was just a man, like you or I, or some of you are women, but if he was just a person and he died on the cross, there were a lot of people during that time that died on the cross. He had to be both fully God, fully human. So because he was fully God, he was perfect. And that was the only way his death could pay for our sins. We'll see that more in a sec. So first, Jesus is fully God, fully man. Second, Jesus is the Messiah. Who knows what the word Messiah means? You ever, anybody used it in conversation this week? Yeah, I don't think so. Right? This is a fancy old Hebrew word that basically means this. It basically means hero. What we would translate as hero. Now, he was this savior, this hero. And where we get this term, it starts from the very beginning. We studied it last semester, Genesis chapter 3. Let's read it together. Genesis chapter 3, starting in verse 14. So what's just happened is this. God's created humanity. He gave them choice. What did they do? They rebelled, right? They chose their own way. And so God finds out that you've sinned against me. He's got to cast them out of the garden. But he speaks to Satan. He speaks to the serpent, the enemy. And he says this to him. Because he was the cause of sin entering the world. Verse 14. Then the Lord God said to the serpent, because you have done this, you're cursed more than all animals, domestic and wild. You'll crawl on your belly and grovel in the dust as long as you live. And this is what he says about his future. Verse 15. I will cause hostility. What does that mean? Hostility. Yeah, it means that they're enemies. It may cause strife and war and pain. It may cause hostility between you, the serpent, and the woman, between her offspring and your offspring. And he says this. So he's saying there's always going to be this struggle between good and evil. But then he says this at the end. He will crush your head. And you will strike. He's a servant, right? So he will crush your head, and you will strike his heel. Who's he talking about? Who's he? Who? A man? Not Satan. God's telling Satan this. Saying he will crush your head. Who's he talking about? This is your part where you go, Jesus. Right? Jesus. That's your answer, right? You see, from the very beginning, this is the third chapter of the Bible. Third chapter of the Bible, he's promising that this is going to happen. That one day, somebody, there's going to be a hero. There's going to be this Messiah. There's going to be this Savior. From the very beginning, he says, look, there's going to be a hero one day. He's going to come and crush the serpent's head. And so that's where these people, all throughout the Old Testament, they're waiting for the Messiah, the hero. Like, they know everything's broken. They know there's this one that's coming one day. He's going to be our hero. He's going to save us from our biggest issue. And what he says is this. Jesus comes, and here's what happens. I'm trying to think what's important because I'm running out of time. See, they expected Jesus to come, and they thought he was just going to take over. Like, he would set up, and he would rule over all their enemies. So I think if we wanted a hero in our day, we want him to come, and he would crush all of our enemies. He would make us powerful, or rich, or healthy, or wealthy. But Jesus wasn't that kind of hero. He wasn't that kind of cure. He wasn't this magic pill. Like, Maddie and I just started a diet on Monday. First diet in my life, so just pray for me. There's all these pills out there. If you're dieting, you're trying to lose weight, your parents probably have a bunch in their medicine cabinet. And there's these promises. If you'll just take this pill, you'll lose all this weight. And sometimes it works for some people. Most of the time it doesn't. They're just trying to sell you something. Right? See, that's what they wanted in Jesus. They wanted this magic pill. You take this, all all your problems will be fixed. But Jesus didn't come for that. He came for one purpose, to crush the serpent's head. And how did he do that? He eventually died on the cross. I'll get to the end there. See, Jesus was our hero in saying that we would point to our troops that are overseas. How many of you have siblings or cousins or parents that are in the military? Yeah? So a good chunk of us have people that have served overseas in war, and we consider them heroes, right? We consider them, we honor them because why? They're willing to give up their life so we don't have to, right? That's what a hero is. See, but Jesus is different. See, because those are our friends. Those are our family. Here's what he says in Romans chapter 5, verse 7 and 8. He says, now most people would not be willing to die for an upright person, though some might perhaps be willing to die for a person who is especially good. But God showed his great love for us by sending Christ, our hero, our Messiah, to die for us while we were still sinners. So when we look at troops as heroes, right? But they're our friends. They're dying for their family. God showed his love for us that while we were still his enemy, he died for us. He sent his son to die for us. There's so much more we can say, but we're going to move on. Jesus is fully God, fully man. Jesus is the Messiah. And third, Jesus is the suffering Lamb of God. Now, anybody that just kind of make you weirded out? You're like, I've been at the Ag Show today. I'm thinking about the sheep that were there. And like, that just doesn't seem like a real positive description of Jesus, right? We think, insert sheep. Jesus is the suffering sheep of God. Like, sheep are dumb, right? There's not any sheep in that. How are there not any sheep? Lambs. But a lamb is a sheep, right? It's a baby. What's the difference between a lamb and a sheep? There isn't? It doesn't matter. So, here's what I want to do. There's a... In John 1:29, this is where we get this sermon, right? John 1:29, John looks at Jesus one day. It says, the next day, John saw Jesus coming toward him. He said, look, the Lamb of God. Kind of a weird name to call somebody, right? Look at that sheep. Look at that goat. Right? Look at the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Now, if you're not an Israelite, if you're not a Hebrew who's familiar with all of this, that's weird, right? So what is he talking about? You see, Jesus, what he's referencing is this Passover feast. Now, you don't even know this probably, but Easter is always around Passover, if I'm correct, on the Jewish calendar. That's why Easter is never the same day, buddy. Never the same weekend in April or May. It's according to this old calendar, and it's when Passover is. Now, anybody ever heard of Passover? Okay, could anybody explain it if I asked you to? Maybe a handful. So here's the story. You got to understand this. To understand that Jesus is the Lamb of God. Okay? God chose these people. They're called the Israelites. He said, stick with me, all right? They are not very big. But God saves them from this famine, and he sends who? Joseph to Egypt. Remember this? We've talked about this. You've read this. Joseph goes to Egypt, becomes powerful. Eventually, the whole family comes in. Right? They move to Egypt. They start to grow like crazy. Like if you raise rabbits produce like crazy. Right? And the Israelites just produce these massive numbers. So there's hundreds, and then there's thousands, and then there's tens of thousands. And all of a sudden, they're getting to be bigger than the Egyptians, okay? So you've got these two people, the Egyptians who are ruling, and the Israelites. They're growing up crazy. A bunch of years pass. The king of the Egyptians doesn't remember where they came from. He just sees them as an enemy. And so what does he do? He takes over. He makes them slaves. He forces them into slavery. They do all the work. They make Egypt this great country, great nation. Hundreds of years pass of slavery. Now, think about that. Think about if you were born at this time when we tell about the Passover. That means your whole life, you've been a slave. Your parents' whole life, they've been slaves. Your grandparents' whole life, they've been slaves. Your family knows nothing but slavery. That's it. So here they are. God doesn't want to see his people enslaved. So what he does is this. He hatches a plan to rescue them from slavery, to liberate them from the slavery to these Egyptians. Okay? So here's his plan. It's the Passover. The plan is the Passover. So what they had to do, this one night, God had done all these plagues. You may have heard of the 10 plagues, yeah? Okay? The last plague is the Passover, kind of. Ish. And that night, what they had to do, they had to get together as a family. They were going to eat this meal together. So the meal consisted of some different herbs and some flatbread and all this other weird healthy stuff, right? They were on a diet too. And but it also consisted of this, a perfect, spotless lamb. So they had to go to their flock, find a perfect lamb. Couldn't have a kind of a bum leg, couldn't have discoloration on its fur. It had to be grand champion, best of show, I don't even know the terms, but it had to be perfect. Okay? They had to go get this lamb, they had to kill it, they had to drain its blood, which sounds weird, yeah? They drain its blood, they prepare it, and they feast on that lamb that night. But here's what God said to do. Here's how you'll be saved. Take some of that blood, wipe it on the doorpost, okay? So when you gather with your family that night, take some of the blood, wipe it on the doorpost. That night, the angel of death was going to go all through Egypt. And he would come to each house, and if the blood was on the door, he would pass over that house, right? He wouldn't do anything. If the blood wasn't there, the firstborn son of that household would die immediately. It didn't matter if you were Israelite, or if you were Egyptian, or if you were a foreigner. The blood was there, he passed over, right? The blood wasn't there, the firstborn son was dead. So that night, they get together. Now, it takes some trust, right? It sounds kind of like a weird plan, you know? Paint some blood on my door, that's weird. Like, how is that going to save this guy? But that night, all these Israelites kill this perfect lamb, put the blood on the doorpost, and the Egyptians didn't. They didn't. And that night, as the angel of death passes through, all of these Egyptian firstborn sons die. And the people of Israel are saved because the blood of the lamb was on their door, right? And Pharaoh gets so upset and I think fearful of God that a God can walk through and just kill every firstborn son, right? And he gets so fearful that he lets the people go. They've been slaves for hundreds of years. They're the only reason Egypt is anything of worth. See, Jews still celebrate this Passover meal every year. They celebrate this feast, and that's what it's around Easter. And, you see, but we don't do it every year. Why not? Why don't we celebrate the Passover every year as Christians? You see, because the Passover was just a picture. It was just a picture of Jesus. It was a picture of this Messiah, this hero that was to come. All right, let me read this. Hebrews 10. This is going to explain it better than I can. Hebrews 10. It says, the old system under the law of Moses was only a shadow. It was a dim preview of the good things to come. So he's talking about killing all these lambs, slaughtering them, all this stuff to save us, to cover our sins. He says, all of that was just a shadow. It had no substance. It was just a preview of the good things to come, not the good things themselves. The sacrifices under that system were repeated again and again, year after year. Verse 2. But they were never able to provide perfect cleansing for those who came to worship. Jews still do this today. They still do most of this today in an attempt to cover their sin. But he's saying it doesn't work. Verse 2. If they could have provided perfect cleansing, the sacrifices would have stopped. For the worshipers would have been purified once for all time, and their feelings of guilt would have disappeared. Verse 3. But instead, those sacrifices actually reminded them of their sins year after year. Verse 4. For it is not possible for the blood of bulls and goats and filling lambs to take away sins. He's saying you can kill as many goats as you want. It's not going to do anything about your relationship with God. Okay, verse 10. Here's the point for us. For God's will is for us to be made holy by the sacrifice of the body of Jesus Christ once for all time. See, we don't have to kill this lamb every year. We don't have to offer sacrifices to God. Why? because Jesus did it once for all. You see, their story, the story of Passover that I just read, is our story, right? We're slaves. We've been slaves to sin. My whole life, that's all I've known. My parents, their whole life, that's all they've ever known. My grandparents, and as far back as I can remember, we've been slaves to a master that doesn't have our best interest in mind. We've been slaves to sin. We didn't have any way to get out, but God had a plan. He wanted to rescue us from that. He wanted us to free us from that. And so God sent what? He sent the Passover. He sent a perfect, spotless lamb to die in our place, right? You see the parallels? And when we stand before God, what matters is not, you know, am I a good person? Did I help that lady across the street? Did I cheat on this test? Whatever. What God's going to look at is one thing, just like that angel of death. What's he going to look at? It's the blood on the door, right? It's the blood of Jesus on that person. If it is, you're saved, right? If you trusted in the blood of Jesus to pay for your sin, then you're free. You're saved. No questions asked. If you haven't, it's real simple. No, you're not. See, the gospel is this. The good news is that there is a way out of our cancerous disease called sin. And what is that way? Yeah, it's Jesus, right? But how? It's his blood. He died on the cross in our place, and he took our punishment. You see, Jesus, John 10:10 says this, that Jesus came to seek and to save that which was lost. Which you and me. Came to save us. He came to be our hero. He came to die in our place so we didn't have to. That's who Jesus is. Let me pray for us, then we're going to spend just a little time in worship. Our song center, I talk so much about what I just read and talked about. So listen, if you don't know the songs, if you're like, I don't like to sing mine, whatever. Read the lyrics. Pay attention to what it's saying. And let it encourage you if you are a Christian. Right? Let sing out praise to God that he died in our place. He took our place when we didn't deserve it. Let's pray. Y'all go ahead and sing. Come on, pray. God, thank you for tonight. I thank you that you love us, God, that you desire to have a relationship with us, God. You don't want to see us stay in slavery, God. You want to see us free from our sin and cured of our cancerous disease called sin, God. I pray, pray that we've been encouraged just that there is a Savior, there is a hero that's come. His name is Jesus. He died on the cross for our sins so we didn't have to suffer slavery the rest of our lives, but ultimately lead to death. God, there is life, there is freedom in you, and so we worship you now for that, and we praise you for all that you've done. And we pray all this in your son's name.